Thank you.
my love.
Yeah. Song of Solomon. Oh, it's my love.
To share a personal testimony of my own, and it'll be brief, but I wanted to share something that has been a very humbling experience for me. So some of you may know, but last year I was preparing to go to law school in Korea, and I'm already a U.S. licensed lawyer, and I work at a law firm, and I do lots of things that are law related. But with a U.S. license, there are certain things that I can't do in Korea. For example, there are limited pro bono opportunities. And for those of you who don't know, pro bono is basically free legal services for people, indigent clients. So law firms, as part of their social corporate responsibility, they provide services to people who need help. But with a U.S. license, because you're not qualified to advise on Korean law, there is a limit to the extent to which you can get involved. And also, my husband and his friends have been involved in trying to fight for, advocate for religious liberties in Korea. And I saw a need for lawyers to young lawyers to be involved in this effort. And I felt that with my current U.S. license, there was a limit to the extent to which I could become involved. For example, if our young people want to file an administrative litigation against the government, I can't get directly involved because I'm not Korea licensed. So I felt this need, and I was praying about it for some time. And in Korea, in order to get a law license, you need to go to law school. They do also have a bar exam separate track, but that's being sort of closed down. And the current regime is to go to law school for 3 years, and then you have to take the exam and you get a license. And 3 years is, you know, sacrifice in terms of the time involved, the financials, and it took me some time to arrive at my decision, but eventually I felt like that would be worth pursuing that separate degree. And so I started preparing for law school. There's a, in order to go to law school, you have to take an exam, a very standardized exam that's common to all the law schools, and then you apply to schools, and if you get accepted, then you start law school. So unlike the exams for the other sectors, fortunately the exams for the law schools are, as yet, not held on Saturday. And so I was able to take that exam last year, and I started applying to schools. But there was a different challenge for me in my case. All the exams for the law schools are, the standardized exam for the law school is not on Saturday, but all the schools' interviews are on Saturday. So in Korea, all the schools, it's not each school setting their own interview date. All the schools get together, they decide on a single date, and every student must go interview on that date. And since the law school system was begun in Korea in 2009, every year the interview has always been on Saturday. And up to last year, or the previous year, the year before, there was one school that had an opening, and that was Seoul National University. And they had a separate early admissions program whereby they would select a very small number of students, and they would test those students, interview those students on Friday instead of Saturday. So that was sort of the very narrow opening that I was looking towards. And it was kind of a long shot because, you know, not only do you have to, your application has to stand out so much that you are selected among that very small group of students who are allowed to interview early. But I felt, you know, if God wants me to become a lawyer in Korea, then, you know, he'll find a way. So I was applying for this program. And then all of a sudden, last year, things happened, and suddenly, there was a huge spike in public interest on improper, unfair conduct in admissions. And so suddenly people were saying, you know, this early admission process that some schools have, it's being used very unfairly. It's, you know, basically very corrupt. You know, like all the people who are well connected get into school through this route. So we should get rid of it. So the very year that I decided to apply and I took the exam, they decided to get rid of that small window at SMU. So, you know, I saw this coming and I knew that it would be a challenge to try to get the schools to change their interview dates. I didn't know if it would be even possible, but I decided, you know, I felt like God wanted me to pursue this, so I kept on preparing for the exam. I filed all my applications. I prepared my personal statement. I was really busy at work, but I found time to do so. I submitted the application. And then suddenly, as I was communicating to schools, at first they were, you know, saying, wow, this is unprecedented. We've never had this kind of request before. You know, it seems like it's only you that this issue concerns. So I was receiving a lot of discouraging feedback. And then suddenly one of the schools said, okay, so we want you to have this opportunity. We don't want you to be locked out of our school because of your religion. So we'll let you interview with us. It'll be on the same date, we can't change the date. But we'll let you interview with us after sundown on Saturday. So we have a lot of applicants coming in to interview during that day, and we'll put you very last on the list. And so the interview time happens after sunset. And I was so happy to hear that. I was saying, that's, you know, answered prayer. God is preparing the way. I was really happy. I was praying. You know, I was nervous about the interview, but I was preparing, reading up on subjects. And then a few days before the exam, less than a week before, I visited the test administrators to talk over some logistical issues. And I found out that they had a very detailed schedule down to the minute on who would interview when. And they had scheduled my interview such that I was in a group where we would go in to the waiting room to be interviewed and receive our interview questions before sundown. And it was 4 minutes before sunset. And it wasn't the actual commencement of the interview. I would get interviewed after sunset, but I would receive the questions before, and I would have 20 minutes to prepare. And that was just such a gray area for me. I was thinking, well, you know, I could just receive the question and not look at it until sundown, and then and then open the question and start the process. And, you know, would that really be much different than, you know, waiting outside for this interview? And at first, you know, and when I consulted my parents about it, they said, you know, it really seems like it's something between you and God, something to decide based on your conscience. So if your conscience bothers you, do it. And, you know, if you're okay and if you think that by doing that you won't be violating the Sabbath, then, you know, go ahead. So I came and I was thinking about it, and at first I told my parents, okay, I've made up my mind. I don't think there is any big issue. I think it's a very technical point, and I think I think God has prepared a way for me to interview at the spot, so I'm going to go in. But then I still felt very bothered in my conscience, and I was thinking, God, why? You know, you might have prepared the way better. You might have arranged things better so that, you know, things would happen well after, you know, sundown. And surely, if you brought me this far, you could have paved the way, smoothed out the way for me a little bit more. And I couldn't shake that thought off my head. And so I was trying to think of what to do, and I was thinking, okay, so God, what are you calling me to do? Do you want me to just say no to these test administrators who have gone through all this trouble of arranging the interview such that I would be able to take it after, go in after Sabbath? Is that what you want? Should I just give up right now? And what struck me was how difficult this decision was for me. Because like I said, I'm already a lawyer. I have a good job, a well-paying job. I already work in the area of law. And this was just something extra that I wanted to do. And before, my rationale had been that, you know, it's God's will for me to become a Korean licensed attorney. So, and I was, more and more I was convicted that I should leave it to God to decide how it would work out. Ultimately, I decided, okay, so I'll go in, and, you know, things happen during the day. Interviews might be pushed back a little bit, drawn out a little bit. So in the event that they, if I can go in after sundown, after Sabbath ends, then I'll do it. And if it's even 1 minute before, then I won't do it. And I communicated this to the test administrators, and I told them, you know, I'm really sorry you've gone through all this trouble, but this is what I'm going to do. So I'm just going to wait and see. And if, you know, if it's early, then I'll just have to leave. I'm really sorry. They said they understood. And this little crisis, I'll tell you what happened later, but this little crisis that I went through it's nothing like what the young people that we told you about last night and this morning go through. I have a job and I have a thing to do and I like working at my job. But when I was faced with this decision, and to some of you it may seem very technical, but when faced with this decision, I felt like theoretically, if I believed in God, then it should have been a no-brainer. Because if God is in control and He exists and He has a plan for me, then of course, you know, things will work out exactly. He will arrange exactly as He wants. And yet it was such, once the rubber met the road, I felt like, oh wow, this is how weak my faith in God is, and I was very humbled. But ultimately, what made me make the decision was that So as long as we live on this earth, we have to exercise faith in order to believe in God, and we'll never have not many of us will have God appearing personally before us to prove to us that I am here and I have you in my hands. But the only thank you. The fact that God exists is the most important thing for me because that's the only hope I have. I've seen my mother again. But I decided that I would choose to believe that God exists.
Amen.
And place everything on Him.
Amen.
So I'll go on to introduce our speaker. Dr. Yoon Kang was a very great support to me throughout this process. He's always willing to listen and help to anybody who's facing the Sabbath exam issue. And he has a personal testimony as well, which could be a sermon in itself. But I'll just briefly summarize it for you here. Dr. Kang, he's an internal medicine specialist, and he entered medical school in 1991. And he graduated in 2000, the year 2000, so it took him 9 years. And during those 9 years, so many things happened. He failed multiple courses, had to take years additional credits. He dropped out of school because he felt like there was no way for him to graduate. He went to study in the States, and then he came back to Korea. Eventually, he was able to, by God's grace, finish medical school. And he told me that for a while, he was thinking whether his years in the U.S. were a waste and why God led him through that circuitous route to becoming a doctor. And recent events have made him realize that that there really was God's providence at work in his going to the U.S. to study, even though ultimately he did not become a doctor in the U.S. Because as he was studying for and taking the MCAT, that's the first time he realized that in the U.S., all you have to do in order to receive religious accommodation is you just sign a form that says that you observe the seven-day Sabbath. And that just means that you just submit the petition, and as easy as that, you don't have to take the test on Saturday. You can take it on a different day. And he'd never experienced a system like that before in Korea, so he didn't know how religious liberty worked on the ground. But that experience helped him to realize that there are alternative systems to our system. And there is, you know, a workable system, and how great would it be to implement that in Korea? So I will invite Dr. Ken to come speak to us about God's Word. Arigatou, everyone.
즐거운 아침입니다. 이 안식일 하나님의 성령께서 여러분과 함께 하시고 또한 하나님의 말씀을 잘 이해하고 우리의 생활 속에 적용할 수 있도록 도와주시길 간절히 바랍니다.
I hope that God's Spirit may speak to your hearts and help us to apply the lessons that we have learned in our lives.
우리 박 자매께서 앞서 아주 귀중한 경험을 우리와 나눠 주셨는데 이 간증의 내용이 또한 오늘의 설교와도 아주 맞닿아 있습니다.
Sister Park's testimony is very fitting with today's message.
오늘의 설교의 제목은 뜻을 정하여입니다.
And today's the title of today's sermon is Purpose in Its Heart.
오늘의 주요 설교 말씀은 다니엘서 1장에 기초하고 있습니다.
The main text for today is Daniel chapter 1.
다니엘의 뜻을 정하여 왕의 진미와 그의 마시는 포도주로 자기를 더럽히지 아니하리라 하고 자기를 더럽히지 않게 하기를 환관장에게 구하니.
But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat nor with the wine which he drank.
잠깐 다니엘서 1장의 배경을 설명하면은
Let me just explain the background of Daniel chapter 1 a little bit.
다니엘은 그 당시 우상 숭배가 아주 만연했던 유다 말기의 여호야김 왕 시대에 살았던 사람이니.
The society in which Daniel lived in before captivity was very idolatrous.
느부갓네살 왕이 유다를 침공했을 때 그때 끌려가서 죄수의 몸으로 바벨론으로 끌려갔습니다.
And when King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon invaded Jerusalem, Daniel was taken in captivity to Babylon.
아마도 그곳에서 노예로 살거나 아니면 죄수의 몸으로 살거나 어쩌면 죽을 수도 있는 절체절명의 위기를 겪었던 것입니다.
And it was a real point of crisis for him. He could either be a slave all his life, or be a prisoner, or even die.
그랬던 순간에 하나님의 은혜로 아주 너무나도 놀라운 기회가 그에게 찾아왔습니다.
But all of a sudden, it seemed like God's grace was at work, and he had a marvelous opportunity.
바로 바벨론에서 박사가 될 수 있는 교육 과정의 기회를 부여받고, 그것을 졸업하면 이제 그곳에서 일하고 정상적인 삶을 살 수 있게 되는 것입니다.
Suddenly, he had the opportunity to enroll in an education institution of higher education in Babylon. Become a PhD and have opportunities in this foreign land.
그런데 그 시스템에 들어가 보니까 아주 조그마한 문제가 생겼어요.
But there was one small problem once he started that course.
그곳에서 제공되는 거기서 음식까지도 다 제공하죠. 그곳에서 제공되는 음식이 왕이 베풀어 준 음식이었는데 그것이 약간 이 유대인이었던 다니엘로서는 용납하기가 어려웠던 내용들이었습니다.
The school that he enrolled in provided food to his students, and the food was of a sort that was difficult for him as a Jew to accept.
그래서 우리가 생각해 볼 문제가 있습니다. 왕이 베푼 호인데 이것을 거절하는 것은 그리스도인으로서 바른 일일까?
So there are several things that questions that come to mind. First of all, is it really Christian to reject the king's favor?
이거 너무 작은 문제가 아닐까?
And this is a really trivial problem, really.
그리고 또 실제로 자기를 담당하고 있던 아스구나스라고 하는 환관장에게 도와주시기를 구했는데 거절당했어요.
And it's not like Daniel didn't try. He already spoke to the person in charge and asked that his food be changed, but his request was rejected.
그 정도 노력했으면 충분하지 않을까?
And you know, he could have thought, haven't I done enough? You
know. 한번 생각해 보겠습니다. 왕의 음식을 거절하는 것은 중요했을까요?
let's think about it a little bit. So how important was it to refuse to eat the king's food?
우리가 이해해야 되는 게 그 당시에 바벨론의 음식은 우상숭배에 바쳐졌던 것입니다.
So one thing we should consider is that the food was one that had been offered to idols.
그래서 그 음식을 먹는다는 것은 그 우상숭배에 동조하고 그것에 함께하겠다는 무언의 표시입니다.
And so eating, partaking of the food would have represented that he was accepting idol worship.
왕은 그렇게 은근히 그 각 나라에 있던 다른 외국인들이 바벨론의 종교와 문화에 동화되기를 바랬기 때문에 그와 같은 것을 고안했던 것입니다.
And this was all part of Nebuchadnezzar's strategy for trying to assimilate all the captive peoples both culturally and religiously.
또한 그 당시에 제공되었던 고기는 보통 부정한 음식이었거나 정한 음식이었다 하더라도 제대로 피를 제거하지 않은 채 조리된 말하자면 율법에 맞지 않는 음식들이었습니다.
And all the meat that was provided was not kosher, so it was either unclean meat or meat that had not been drained of blood.
이것은 분명하게 그들이 알고 있던 하나님의 계명을 어기는 일이었던 것이었습니다.
And this was clearly against God's commandment to his people.
하지만 여전히 문제가 났습니다. 이걸 거절한다는 것은 거절하기에는 너무나 큰 기회이고 거절해야 하는 문제는 그에 비해서 너무나 작은 문제는 아닐까?
But still, it was such a great opportunity and the violation was so small and possibly even technical.
왕의 음식을 받아들이지 않을 수 있는 핑계거리는 많았습니다.
And excuses abounded for complying with the king's request.
내가 정한 음식이 아니고 강요된 거 아니냐? 어차피 나는 책임이 없다.
It's not my choice. I was coerced. I had no alternative.
여기에서 퇴출되면은 끝이다.
And this is my only chance. If I get kicked out of the school, then it's over for me.
호의를 거절하는 것은 이웃의 호의를 거절하는 것은 하나님의 뜻이 아닐 것이다.
And it'll be really rude to refuse to eat the food, and it's probably not God's purpose.
그렇게 합리화할 수 있죠.
There are many ways that he could justify himself.
또 이런 생각을 할 수 있습니다. 호의를 거절하고 율법대로 너무 엄격하게 그렇게 하면 괴짜로 보이는 거 아니냐?
And you could have also thought that I'll just look so strange if I stick to the letter of the law.
그러다가 전도할 기회를 놓치면 어떻게 하냐?
And that may close doors, opportunities for evangelism even.
그다음에 딱 3년만 수련하면 끝인데 그 더 큰 greater good 더 큰 일을 위해서 대의를 위해서. 이거 잠깐 희생하는 거 이거 하나님의 뜻이 아닐까?
And he could have also thought, you know, this course is just for 3 years, so why not just compromise a little bit for the greater good?
잠시인데, 자그마한 문제인데.
It was just a little while, just a little problem.
네, 생각해 보겠습니다. 하나님께서 보시기에 자그마한 의무라는 것은 있는가?
But let's consider this a little bit. Is any duty truly trivial in God's sight?
2011년 2월에 연합 뉴스에 보고된 뉴스가 하나 있었습니다.
So in 2011 there was an article in 연합 뉴스.
부산에서 광명역으로 이제 출발했던 KTX 기차가 탈선을 했었습니다.
KTX train on its way from Busan to Gwangmyeong got derailed.
다행히 많은 사람이 다치진 않았지만 굉장히 큰 사고였습니다.
Unfortunately, there were not many who were gravely injured, but still, it was a very big accident.
이 사고를 조사해 보니까 조그마한 노트, 볼트라고 해야 되나요? 나사가 하나, 7mm짜리 나사가 꽉 조여지지 않았기 때문에 일어난 사고였습니다.
And once they did the fact finding on what went wrong, they found that it was caused by a small 7mm bolt that had not been tightened properly.
조그만한 정말 누구도 보기도 힘들 손톱보다도 더 작은 이 작은 나사 하나를 꽉 조이지 못한 것 때문에 일어난 대형 사고.
And it was, you know, smaller than even a fingernail. This very small bolt that you can't even see very well. That was what caused the accident.
인류의 역사상 성경을 볼 때에도 그런 자그마한 우리가 소홀하기 쉬운 그런 의무 하나 때문에 일어난 큰 사건 없었을까요?
So considering biblical history and human history as a whole, do you think that there are no other instances where a big accident was caused by a very small issue.
간단하게 우리 선악과를 한번 생각해 봅시다.
Let's think about the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil.
그냥 과일 하나를 먹느냐 안 먹느냐 하는 간단한 문제였습니다.
It was a very, you know, simple problem whether or not to eat fruit.
근데 이 작은 의무 한 가지를 어긴 다음에 마치 나비 효과처럼 온 인류에게 닥쳐온 것은 너무나 큰 죄악과 죽음과 슬픔과 고통과 질병과 그와 같은 큰 고통들이었습니다.
But from that very small sin, like a butterfly effect, a tsunami of sin and tragedy, of pain and suffering, enveloped the whole globe.
또 한번 생각해 봅시다. 아주 유다에는 너무나 유명하고 아주 자비로운 여호사밧이라는 하나님을 경외하는 왕이 있었습니다.
There's another example in Jehoshaphat, who the Bible describes as a very good king who loved the Lord.
하나님을 사랑하고 하나님 말씀을 전했어요, 항상.
He loved the Lord and he always talked about God.
근데 그가 했던 가장 자그마한 한 실수가 있었는데.
But he had a one mistake, very small.
그의 아들을 하나님을 믿지 아니하는 아합 집안의 딸과 결혼을 시킨 것이었어요.
He sent his son to be married into the household of Ahab, who did not revere God.
예, 하나님을 믿지 않은 자와 멍에를 같이 매지 말라는 가장 작아 보이는 하나의 의무를 어긴 것 때문에 엄청난 일들이 일어났었습니다.
And because he violated that seemingly small commandment not to be unequally yoked, some great things or tragic things happened.
그의 아들들, 그의 큰아들인 그 여호람을 제외한 나머지 아들들은 바로 그 큰아들에 의해서 다 살해를 당했고
All his sons, with the exception of his eldest, were killed by that eldest son.
손자와 증손자에 이르기까지 모두 다 하나님을 떠나서 그야말로 가장 어두운 암흑기를 지내게 되었습니다.
His grandsons and great grandsons all left the Lord, and the country went into a period of darkness.
다윗 왕은 어떻습니까?
How about David?
자그마한 게으름 때문에 그는 바세바에 대해서 간음이라는 죄를 저지르게 되었습니다.
Because of a small moment of laziness, he came to sin with Bathsheba.
아주 신실했던 히스기야 왕조차도 그가 작은 교만을 가졌기 때문에 그의 모든 것들이 결국 바벨론으로 가게 되는 엄청난 일을 겪게 되었습니다.
And Hezekiah, who is one of the most faithful, who is one of the most faithful servants of God in the Old Testament, because he had that very small moment of pride, ultimately all his possessions were taken to Babylon.
Next passage. Our translator, we will read the passage for saving time.
I'll just read the passage. As God called Daniel to witness for him in Babylon, so he calls us to be his witnesses in the world today. In the smallest as well as the largest affairs of life, he desires us to reveal to men the principles of his kingdom. Many are waiting for some great work to be brought to them. While daily they lose opportunities for revealing faithfulness to God, daily they fail of discharging with wholeheartedness the little duties of life. While they wait,
그들은 어떻게 그렇게 확고할 수 있었을까요?
Going back to the story of Daniel, how possibly could they stand so firm?
아시다시피 많은 핑계를 댈 수 있었죠. 감염된 죄악에 난 책임이 없다. 오히려 거절하는 것은 이웃 사랑이 아니다 등등.
Like we said, there are so many good excuses that he was coerced, or that he was being polite, that you know it was an opportunity to prosper, or that God really isn't as picky as you think.
Okay, please read the next passage.
In Prophets and Kings, Sister Wyatt writes, "Had Daniel so desired, he might have found in his surroundings a plausible excuse for departing from strictly temperate habits." He might have argued that, dependent as he was on the king's favor and subject to his power, there was no other course for him to pursue than to eat of the king's food and drink of his wine. For should he adhere to the divine teaching, he would offend the king and probably lose his position and his life. Should he disregard the commandment of the Lord, he would retain the favor of the king and secure for himself intellectual advantages and flattering worldly prospects. But Daniel did not hesitate. The approval of God was dearer to him than the favor of the most powerful earthly potentate, dearer than life itself. He determined to stand firm in his integrity, let the result be what it may.
Amen.
그에게는 하나님의 인정받는 것이 세상에서 가장 강한 군주의 총애를 받는 것보다 더욱 귀중했고 생명 그 자체보다 귀중했다.
Read again. The approval of God was dearer to him than the favor of the most powerful earthly potentate.
여러분에게 예수님은 어떤 존재입니까?
What is Jesus Christ to you?
세상 어떤 것보다도 귀한 여러분의 구주이십니까?
Is he the Savior who is more valuable to you than anything else in the world?
왜 다니엘이 작은 의무를 작은 의무로 보지 않고 그렇게 신실했는지에 대한 힌트를 얻을 수 있겠죠?
Yeah, I think from our discussion we can get a glimpse of why Daniel decided to stick with his faith even on the very small points.
히브리서 11장 24절에서 26절. 믿음으로 모세는 장성하여 바로의 공주의 아들이라 칭함을 거절하고 도리어 하나님의 백성과 함께 고난받기를 잠시 죄악의 낙을 누리는 것보다 더 좋아하고 그리스도를 위하여 받는 능력을 애굽의 모든 보화보다 더 큰 재물로 여겼으니 이는 상주심을 바라봅니다.
By faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward.
여러분, 믿음이란 단순히 그래 예수님께서 십자가에 돌아가셨어 나 그거 알아 라고 인정만 하는 것이 아닙니다.
Faith is not about just acknowledging that, okay, I know that Jesus died on the cross for me.
믿음이란 비록 눈에 보이는 번영의 증거는 없을지라도 구원하시는 그리스도의 사랑과 하나님의 신실하심을 확신하기 때문에 반드시 이루어 주실 그분의 약속에 소망을 두고 확고히 그분의 뜻을 따라 살아가는 것입니다.
Faith is holding on to his promise. Even when you can't see ahead, even when you can't see immediately what he has prepared for you.
그러면 이렇게 살아갔던 사람은 누가복음 아까 우리가 읽었던 요한복음 6장 10절의 말씀처럼 정말 작은 것에서 충성했던 것만큼 큰 것에서도 충성했던 사람들이었을까요?
So do you think it's true what it says in Luke that he that is faithful in which is also faithful in much?
다니엘서 3장에 보면은 사드락과 메삭과 아브네고가 왕에게 대답할 가로되 느부갓네살이여 우리가 이 일에 대하여 왕에게 대답할 필요가 없나이다. 만일 그럴 것이면 왕이여 우리가 섬기는 우리 하나님이 우리를 긍휼히 타는 풀무 가운데서 능히 건져내시겠고 왕의 손에서도 건져내시리라. 그리 아니하실지라도 왕이여 우리가 왕의 신들에게 절 섬기지도 아니하였나 아니하고 왕이 세우신 금신상에 절하지도 아니할 줄 아옵소서.
Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up.
자그마하게 보이는 의무에도 충직했던 그들은 불이 타고 있는 풀무를 바라보면서도 하나님께 충성하기를 멈추지 않았어요.
Because they had been faithful to God in their food, they were able to be faithful to God when the greater test came.
이제 우리 눈을 돌려서 미래를 한번 바라보십시다.
Let's think about what's coming ahead.
Would you read the passage, please?
Saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name.
시간 관계상 우리가 이 모든 것들 다 해석할 수 있는 일이 그렇게 할 시간 없지만.
Given time constraints, we can't delve deeply into this prophecy.
우리가 미래에 신앙을 강요받을 사건이 있을 것이라는 것을 알고 있습니다.
But we, as a people who have received a message, know that in the end times there will be a time when our religious liberty will be truly put.
그와 같은 사건을 우리가 만날 생각해 볼 때 오늘의 문제를 어떻게 해결할까를 우리 생각하게 됩니다.
And so looking ahead to that time, we have to think about what we should be doing today.
많은 사람들이 일요일 휴업령이라고 하는 것이 이 미래에 올 것이라는 것을 예언을 통해서 배우고 알게 되면서 이런 생각을 하는 사람들이 있어요. 그때 그런 일이 생길 때 하나님 편에 굳게 서야 합니다.
And many people, as Adventists, we learn about the Sunday law, about the great persecution at the end times, and we come to think that, okay, I know the prophecy, so when that happens, I'll be able to stand firm.
그런데 실상은 우리가 오늘 하나님의 편을 택하지 못하면 그때도 못하게 될 가능성이 많습니다.
But if we don't choose to be on God's side today, then there is a high possibility that we won't be strong enough to stand when the real test comes.
하나님의 말씀 우리에게 이렇게 권면하고 있습니다. 형제들아, 너희가 삶과 혹 너희 중에 누가 믿지 아니하는 악심을 품고 살아계신 하나님에게서 떨어질까 염려할 것이요. 오직 오늘이라 일컫는 동안 매일 비차에 권하여 너희 중에 누구든지 죄의 유혹으로 강팍하게 되면 면하라.
Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily, while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin.
Today, 오늘 우리가 선택할 필요가 있습니다.
Today, we need to make the decision.
Prophets and kings, please read the passage.
Should they compromise with wrong in this instance by yielding to the pressure of circumstances, their departure from principle would weaken their sense of right and their abhorrence of wrong. The first wrong step would be to others until their connection with heaven severed, they would be swept away by temptation.
오늘날 한국의 재림교인들은 굉장히 큰 위험에 직면해 있습니다.
Today, young Adventists are at risk.
앞서 안식학교 시간과 저녁 지난 금요일에도 말씀드렸던 것처럼
As we discussed during the Sabbath school program and also yesterday during Vespers
지난 2007년 이후로 국가 시험과 자격 시험들이 거의 모두 토요일에 치러지는 걸로 바뀌고 있어요.
Ever since 2007 the Almost all national exams and licensing exams are being held on Sabbath.
37개 산업 인력 공단의 시험이라든가.
The Human Resources Development Service administers 37 exams, and all 37 are held on Sabbath.
보건의료 국가 시험원에서 치러지는 모든 의료계 관계되는 시험이라든가.
And all the exams relating to healthcare, the healthcare field, so dentists and doctors and many others.
공무원 시험이라든가 교사 임용 고시라든가.
And public service exams and public school teacher exams.
대학원 시험이라든가 대학들의 입학 시험이라든가.
And graduate school and college admissions.
직장 면접 시험이라든가.
And many job interviews all take place on the Sabbath.
한국에서는 대학원에 들어가서 안식을 지키면서 대학원에 들어가 박사 학위를 딸 수가 없습니다.
And in Korea, it's almost impossible to go to graduate school and graduate while keeping the Sabbath.
산역대학의 박사 학위를 가진 교수님 뽑기가 이제 쉽겠습니까?
And so from now on, it'll soon become really difficult for Samik University to find qualified professors who have a doctorate.
임상병리사 시험이 다 토요일이에요.
The clinical
임상병리사
engineer tests or exams are all on Sabbath. Medical laboratory technologist exams.
위생병원에서 임상병리사는 이제 뽑을 수 있겠습니까? 아주 신실하게 안식을 지키려고 할 때.
And so now at our Adventist hospital, it'll be difficult for us to find really devout Adventist medical laboratory technologists because they won't be there.
실제로 이런 일이 일어나고 있습니다.
And these things are unfolding right now.
제가 많이 듣기로는 임상병리사 시험을 포기하고 딴 길을 걸어간 사람들에 대해서 들었고.
And I've heard many stories of devout Adventists who have decided to give up their dream of becoming a medical laboratory technologist.
오늘 뭐 의사 고시를 포기했던 예에 대해서 들었을 겁니다.
And we've already told you about the three students who decided not to take the licensing exam.
몇 년을 공부하고도 공무원 시험을 결국 포기한 사람들도 있습니다.
Many people give up on their dream of becoming a civil servant after many years of study.
대학원을 포기하고
they give up going to graduate school.
어떤 사람들은 군에서 안시점수를 못해서 장교 후보생에서 쫓겨난 사람들도 있어요.
And some are kicked out of their eligibility to be an officer of the military because of their Sabbath observance.
많은 사람들이 생각할 것입니다. 한 번 치는 시험 아니야? 그렇게 까다롭게 그걸 굴어야 될 필요가 있을까?
And a lot of people say this is one exam. Can God possibly excuse that one violation?
아마도 100년 전에 마이군이 살던 그 시대 미국이나 유럽에도 비슷한 문제가 있었던 것 같아요.
And I think that in Ellen White's time, there must have been a similar issue in the States and in Europe.
그 당시에는 토요일에 학교를 가지 않는다고 유럽의 어느 지역에서는 아예 강제로 학교를 데려가 감옥에 넣는 경우도 있었다고 합니다.
At the time in Europe, there were some cases where people, if somebody refused to go to school on Sabbath, they would drag you to school or put you in prison.
좀
Some will urge that God, the Lord is not so particular in His requirements that it is not their duty to keep the Sabbath strictly at so great loss, or to place themselves where they will be brought into conflict with the laws of the land. But here is just where the test is coming, whether we will honor the law of God above the requirements of men. This is what will distinguish between those who honor God and those who dishonor Him. Here is where we are to prove our loyalty. The history of God's dealings with His people in all ages shows that He demands exact obedience.
우리가 하나님의 율법을 인간의 율법보다 더욱 존중할 것인지 아닐 것인지 하는 시험을 받는 것이 바로 이 점이에요.
But here is just where the test is coming, whether we will honor the law of God above the requirements of men.
우리가 세상의 것을 가장 귀한 것으로 여길 것인가? 아니면 예수 그리스도가 정말 나에게 가장 그 어느 것보다 귀한 분이신가? 그것을 우리가 시험받게 될 것입니다.
Whether we value the treasures of this earth above all else, or whether Christ reigns supreme.
이건 그냥 율법주의적인 생각이 아닐까? 이렇게 생각할 수도 있습니다.
And you might wonder whether you know this is not being legalist.
어떻게 이렇게 엄격하게 할 수 있어? 너무 어렵다. 이렇게 생각할 수 있어요.
Too strict and too burdensome.
어떤 한 목사님이 설교 중에 그 앞에 계시고 있는 어떤 교수님을 한번 불러 세우셨어요.
One time a pastor was in the middle of his sermon and he asked a professor to stand up.
교수님은 아내가 있으십니까?
He asked, "Professor, do you have a wife?"
네, 있습니다.
Yes, I do.
교수님은 그 아내에게 거짓말하는 것이 쉬우십니까?
Is it easy for you to lie to your wife?
아니요.
No, it's really hard.
교수님은 그 아내분을 두고 다른 여자를 사랑해서 쫓아다니고 그와 함께 지내는 것을 좋아하십니까? 아니요.
Do you like chasing after other women and giving your affection to them?
교수님은 아내가 밉다고 두들겨 패거나 죽일 마음을 가지고 그렇게 행동하는 것이 쉬우십니까?
And when you fight with her, is it easy for you to beat her up and try to kill her?
No. 아니 왜 그렇게 안 하십니까?
Why don't you do it?
그거 쉽지 않아요?
Isn't it easy?
No.
No.
왜요? 물었어요.
And pastor asked why? Why is it not easy?
저는 아내를 사랑합니다.
That's because I love my wife.
여러분, 이슈는 그것입니다. 정말 진심으로 하나님과 우리 주 예수 그리스도를 사랑하십니까?
The crux of the matter is this. Whether do you deeply in your heart sincerely love God?
그렇게 되면은 작은 문제이냐 아니냐 이런 건 더 이상 질문이 되지 않을 것입니다.
And once you have the love of God in your heart, it will no longer matter whether or not it's a small issue.
그리하여 이제 마지막 메시지로 여러분이 가지고 갈 take-home 메시지가 있습니다.
I have some take-home messages for you.
여기 혹시 시험을 만나는 우리 재림 청년들이 있습니까?
If there are any among you who are facing this problem right now,
나를 존중히 여기는 자를 내가 존중히 여기리라고 말씀하신 말씀을 기억하십시오.
Amen.
Please remember God's words to you. For them that honor me, I will honor.
Amen.
다니엘과 그 친구처럼 하늘을 바라보고 말씀을 기억하고 용기를 내십시오.
Amen.
Just like Daniel and his three friends, keep your eyes on heaven, remember his promises, and take courage.
그리고 여기 계신 성도들 중 이와 같은 거와는 관계 없다고 혹시 생각하실 수 있는 여러분들이 있다면,
and for the rest of you, for whom this is not an immediate issue,
그들을 위해서 기도해 주시기 바랍니다.
Please pray for your brothers and sisters in need.
네.